Hello, my name is Keshwani. That's K-E-S-H-W-A-N-I, Keshwani. We are here because we want to prepare for the GMAT. We have been solving GMAT math problems out of this book here, GMAT Review, the official guide, the 13th edition. If you do not own this book already, purchase one immediately. You're going to need it. The book contains 230 problem solving questions. It has 174 data sufficiency questions. We have already solved every single math problem from this book. If you're interested in watching the original solutions to the problems, you will find the original solutions from day number 1 through 250. Right now, we are in the process of redoing the problems and we are on page number 289. Let's turn to it, please. Page number 289, the very first problem that you see there in the second column, number 152. Let's see what it has to say. In number 152, we are being asked here, we are told that the area of the triangular region, D equals 4. The question simply is, what's the length of side, what's the length of the side of square A? Let's see what the picture looks like. So here's the small triangle that is given to us. Let's see if we can do a decent job. It looks like this. Here's our small triangle. Here's the square, which they're calling B. Here we have another square, which they're calling A, and we are told the area, not this is D. And D is going to be down here somewhere. This is D right here. This is the D. The area of this guy is 4. This region is 4. And here's the region C. Tell you what, to make our life easier, because this center portion is what we're interested in, let's give these vertices names so we can talk about this triangle. P, Q, R. That's what they're telling us. We're told, right here, the area of the triangular region D equals 4, which is same as saying that the area of the triangle PQR equals 4. The question is, what's the length of the side of square A? Square A is this guy right here. In other words, what we're interested in, how much is P to Q? That's what we're interested in. The side of square A that they're talking about, what's the length of the side of square A? Square A is right here. This is the side we're interested in. We have to figure out how long is PQ. That's what we're... And we know that the area of the triangle PQR is 4. Let's see what we can do, shall we? Let's look at the first statement. Tell you what, because we need the room, let's put all of this thing here. So we know that the area of the triangle PQR is 4, and the question is, how much is P to Q? How much is P to Q? We don't need any of this stuff anymore. Let's look at the first statement. Let's see what they have to say in the first statement. In the first statement, they tell us that the area of the square region B is 9. Square region B is right here, the small one. The area of the square region B is 9. Well, that is same as saying, if B is 9, that means Q to R has to be 3. Q to R is 3. That's all, because it's a square. It's 3 times 3 is 9. So now we have a triangle here. We have our triangle PQR. PQR. And we just found out that Q to R is 3. The question is, how much is this side? But we also know that the area of the whole thing is 4. So how do we find the area of the whole thing? Area of the whole thing is 1 half base, let's call it x base, times height, which we know is 3, equals 4. Okay, keep listening. In the real exam, we're not going to actually solve the whole thing. You understand? We just have to understand the steps. We just have to understand the procedure and have to work through in our mind the steps that we have to take and decide whether or not we have sufficient data. So here we go. We can obviously figure out the x. we know 1/2 base, which is what we're calling x times the height, which we just found out is 3 because the area of this thing is 9. We can clearly figure out the length of this side. Once we have the length of PR, we know the length of QR. Obviously, we can figure out PQ by simple use of Pythagorean theorem. That's all. The first statement does the job quite beautifully. AD, BCE. AD, BCE. Now that we established the first statement by itself is enough, we know now, answer cannot be B, C, or E. Answer would have to be either A or D. What we're going to do from this point on for a little bit, for the next 1 minute or so, 1 or 2 minutes, is just for learning purposes. This is not something we'll waste our time in the real exam. We can actually finish it up. It doesn't take that long. We're going to finish it up. So X would have to equal 4 times 2, which is 8 over 3. This is 8 over 3. Let's put it in here. It's not that big of a deal. It's 8 times 3. And the hypotenuse here, hypotenuse square, has to equal this side squared, which is 3 squared, plus that side squared, which is 8 squared over 3 squared. That's it. There you go. That's the hypotenuse square. So it's just going to be 9 times 9, which is 81, plus 64. 81, because 9 times 9 is 64 over 9. And I bet you this amount, when you add them up, I bet you that's also going to be a perfect square, because that's the h square. 4 plus 1 is 5. And 4 plus 1 is 5, and, oh, it's 145. What the hell? It's 145 over 9. It's not a perfect square. It doesn't matter. It's not a perfect square. It's not a big deal. The point here is that the height that they're looking for is simply the square root of 145 over 9, whatever the hell that happens to be. Do you understand? That's all it is. Let's go to second statement, shall we? Let's go to second statement. We're done with all of this thing. Just give me a quick break here. All of this thing is gone. Second statement. All of this thing is gone. This thing is given in the problem itself. The area of the region D is 4. That is given in the problem. The question is, how much is P to Q? Let's see what the second statement tells us. Second statement tells us that the area of the square C is 64 over 9. Area of the square C. See, area of the square C is 64 over 9. That implies that P to R must be square root of that amount, which is 8 over 3. Well, there you go. Same exact procedure as before. Nothing has changed. So now we know here's our triangle. We know this is 8 over 3. We know the area is 4. Since the area is 4, 1/2 base, which is 8 over 3, times height, let's call it Y, this has to equal 4. Obviously, we can figure out the Y. Once we have the Y, we can figure out the hypotenuse. The second statement does the job quite nicely as well. The answer is D. The answer is D. Each of the statement does the job quite nicely. Let's finish it up, shall we? So Y is equal to, here's the 4, here's the 8, that's the 2, that's the 2, that's the 2. So Y is equal to 3. There you go. Of course Y is equal to 3. Nothing is going to change. As I always point out to you, these statements, the information in each of these two statements, never contradict each other. If the first statement told you that this length of this side is 3, no matter how they present the information in the second statement, if it is sufficient information, and if you work it out, you will find that it will also give you 3. We just found out Y is equal to 3 right there, which is exactly what we had found before. That's it. Same as before. Y is equal to 3. The hypotenuse is going to be this square plus that square. Same as before. We're not going to actually do it. Let's move on to 153, shall we? There's no point in redoing the same thing. There's nothing new in it. It's the exact same procedure. It's a simple application of the Pythagorean theorem. Number 153. In the 153, they tell us that Sarah is twice as old as Bill. Sarah is twice as old as Bill. If we were to use letter S to represent Sarah's age now, S represents Sarah's age now, then Sarah is twice as old as Bill. If we were to represent letter B for Bill's age right now, then Sarah's age is 2 times as much. There you go, this is our first equation. And obviously we're dealing with two unknowns, Sarah's age and Bill's age. We have one equation, they're giving us one equation. if we can find one more equation from each of the statements there, we are home free. Two equations, two unknowns, we are done. That's it. That's all we have to understand here. We don't actually have to do the work. That's the beauty of these questions. Data sufficiency questions is a double-edged sword. They do tend to be a little bit more tricky, but at the same time, we don't actually have to do the work. We just have to understand whether or not we have sufficient data. Data sufficiency. Get it? Let's see what they give. Let's see what they tell us in the first statement. In the first statement, they tell us that 4 years ago, this is actually a good sign, 4 years ago, and they're about to tell us their respective ages. That's our second equation right there. 4 years ago, Sarah was thrice as old as Bill. 4 years ago, Sarah's age was thrice as old. Is that actually how they say it? I doubt very much if they use the word thrice. They say three times. Three times. Thrice is what I put down here. Thrice. The reason I looked down is because I knew that most likely they will not use that word. We learned this word thrice before. I'm digressing here. Forgive me 1 second. I can't help it. I'm compulsive. Thrice. When did we learn the word thrice? It's a very simple word. I know that.
Day 63.
If you're interested in improving your vocabulary to get a better score in the reading portion of the exam, and I see no reason why you wouldn't be interested in improving your vocabulary, not just for the exam, but just life, for life in general, just type in GMAT vocabulary words, GMAT vocabulary words, day number 63, and watch that video. You will learn the word thrice along with some other words having to do with time period and having to do with quantity. For example, do you know what the period of 2 decades is called? Or what are the proper terminologies, what are the proper words for something that happens every 2 weeks and something that happens twice a week, or something that happens every other year and something that happens twice a year, and so on and so forth. Learn those words. Do you understand? Very good. That's it. That's our second equation. We have two equations. Here's equation number two. Here's equation number one. Here's our second equation. Two equations, two unknown. We have two independent equations, two unknown. Of course, it's enough. AD, BCE. The first statement by itself does the job quite nicely. AD, BCE. Now that we have established that the first statement by itself is enough, we know now that the answer cannot be B, C, or E. It would have to be either A or D. If it turns out that the second statement is also sufficient by itself, then the answer is D. Otherwise, it will remain A. Again, from what we're going to do from this point on, it's a sheer waste of time if you were to do it in a real exam. It is not something that you want to do in a real exam. It is not necessary. It is not required. It will be thoroughly gratuitous. Do you understand? It will be thoroughly gratuitous. Unneeded, unwanted, unrequired, unnecessary, uncalled for. Do you understand? But we're going to do it anyway. Why, do you ask? Because we are masochistic. I'm not going to put down all the words here. We will keep coming up. And we don't want to go in masochism, do you understand? But we did learn the word masochistic, I remember that. Or at least I think we did. No, we never learned it. So we're not going to go there. Let's do it together, shall we? 4 years ago. How old was Sarah 4 years ago? Well, Sarah is S year old today. Today, Sarah is S years old. Well, that implies that 4 years ago, I'm not going to write everything down there. That implies that 4 years ago, she was S minus 4. Whatever is her age is today, if you take away 4 from it, that's how old she was 4 years ago. And at that time, her age was 3 times the age of Bill's at that time. How old was Bill 4 years ago? Well, Bill is B years old today. Bill is B years old today. Well, 4 years ago, he must have been B minus 4. There is our second equation. There you go. That's our second equation. Two equations, two unknown. We just substitute one variable for the other and solve for it. For example, we know S equals 2 times B. Let's put it in here. S equals 2 times B. Put it in here. S equals 2 times B minus 4 equals 3 times B. And 3 times 4 is negative 12. Subtract 2B from both sides. There is a positive B. Subtract 2B from both sides. And add 12 to both sides. And we are done. Positive 2b and negative 2b cancels out. Negative 4 and a positive 12 is going to give us positive 8. 3b minus 2b is b. And negative 12 and a 12 goes out. There you go. Bill today is 8 years old. The question was, what the hell was the question? What are they asking for? How old is Sarah? Well, Bill is 8 years old and Sarah is twice as old. Sarah is 16 years old, that's all. Let's look at second. Let's look at second statement, shall we? Let's do it on top. Let's do it on top. Remember, we know this. This equation is given to us. Where can we put it? S equals 2b. We'll just remember it. S equals 2b. Let's see what they tell us in the second statement. In the second statement, they say that 8 years from now, well, there you go, 8 years from now, 8 years from now, unless of course they're going to go on and tell us something silly like from 8 years from now Sarah is going to get married, then that's a different story. But of course, in most likely case, they're going to tell us what their ages are going to be, how their ages are going to compare. Well, there you go, again, two equations, two unknown. That's going to give us one equation, and we already have the first equation. Sarah is twice as old as Bill. This is our first equation. Here we see second equation coming up. 8 years from now, Sarah's age, Sarah will be time and a half. I'm not writing everything. Time and a half as old as Bill. How do they say it? Obviously, they're not going to say it. 8 years from now, Sarah's age will be exactly 1.5 times Bill's age. Sarah will be time and a half. There's our second equation. Again, we have one equation here, we have another equation here, we have two independent equations, two unknown. Of course, we can solve for two unknown using the two equations, no matter how complicated the equations may be. But of course, here they are not complicated at all. They are just simple linear equations. Second statement by itself does the job also quite nicely. Answer to this problem is D. Again, what we are about to embark on is something that is not something one does in the real exam. It'll be damn silly, it'll be foolish, it'll be a bloody waste of time to do in the real exam. We can actually do it out, you understand? Why do you ask again? I already told you, because we are masochistic. We don't need any of this thing. Now remember, when we do the work, we better not get a different answer. We got the answer that Bill is 8 years old, Sarah is 16 years old. The information in the two statements, they never ever contradict each other. They always substantiate each other. So if we do the work in the second statement and find out that Bill happens to be something other than 8 years old, that would mean either the work that we did in the second statement is wrong, or the work that we did in the first statement is wrong, or perhaps both of these works are wrong. But they cannot contradict each other. We better find the same values. Do you understand? Eight years from now, Sarah is 8 years old today. 8 years from now, she's going to be S plus 8. That's going to be her age. At that time, she's going to be time and a half, which is 3/2, of Bill's age. How old is Bill going to be 8 years from now? He's B years old today. If he's B years old today, 8 years from now, he's going to be B plus 8. It's going to be B plus 8, and therefore multiply both sides by 2, and we can get rid of this 2, and we get 2 times S plus 16, 2 times S plus 16 equals 3 times B plus 24. But we know 2 times S, it's 2 times B. Bloody hell. So what do you want to substitute for? Let's put in for S, S equals 2B. Plus 16 is equals 3B plus 24. That's 4B, that's 3B. Let's subtract 3B from both sides. Let's subtract 3B from both sides and let's subtract 16 from both sides. There we go. Positive 16 and negative 16 is going to drop out. 24 minus 16 and positive 3 and a negative 3b is going to drop out. 24 minus 16 is going to give us 8. And this is 4b. 4b minus 3b is 1b. What do you know? Bill is 8 years old, therefore Sarah must be 16. Of course they're not going to give us a different answer. They better not. Let's move on to the last question on the page, number 154. I need a break as usual.
Why do you ask? Why do I need the break after every problem? I told you that before also a long time ago because I'm a baby. Do you understand? Number 154.
We are told that we have a report. We are told that we have a report that consists of 2,600 words.
2,600 words it has.
It is made up of 23 paragraphs.
23 paragraphs it has.
We are also told that it has a two paragraph
preface. How do we pronounce this word?
We learned this word long time ago.
It's not to be pronounced preface. And the reason I make a fuss about it is because being a non-native speaker, I found out that sometimes we tend to pronounce the words as they are written. But that is not always the case. It is not to be pronounced preface, it is preface.
We learned this word on the second day. Vocabulary, day two.
We are told that it has a two paragraph preface,
which we're going to add. We're going to add a preface to it. And the question is this. The question simply is the average number of words, if the average number of words per paragraph over the whole 25 paragraph less than 120.
So one more time, we know that we have 2,600 words in 23 paragraphs. In 23 paragraphs, let's erase that part from last time, to which we add a preface consisting of two paragraphs. The question is the average number of words per paragraph after having added the preface less than 120 words? That's all it is. Interesting question. Now listen again, before we look at the two statements, let's observe this information, let's understand what we can extract from it, which will help us quite a lot down the road. It will come in quite handy. So let's spend some time and analyze it. Okay, listen to me. I'm not going to write everything down, so listen to me and try to understand what's going on here. Very first thing we're going to do is figure out what's the average for the 23 paragraphs that we have without the preface. Let's do it here.
2,600 words and we have 23 paragraphs. These are the words, these are the paragraphs.
They have 23 paragraphs, 2,600 words in it. Let's find out how many words per paragraph.
How many 23s in a 26?
How many 23 in a 26? 26 has one 23. The remaining 3 goes and joins a 0. The remaining 3 goes and joins a 0 becomes 30. How many 23s in a 30? 30 has 1 23. After we take away 23 from 30, we are left with 70. That 7 goes and joins a 0. That 7 goes and joins a 0 becomes a 70, which is being divided by 23. 70 divided by 23. We're going to pretend
that 70 is actually 69.
Why do you ask? Because we like to keep our life simple. 69 has how many 23s? It has exactly 3 23s.
In other words, it comes out to be approximately 113 words per paragraph
as it stands right now without having added the preface. Are you with me so far? I'm going to pick up speed here now. The question is, In order for it to reach
120
words exactly, the question is it less than 120? If we can somehow show that it is 120 or more, then of course it's not less than 120. In order for it to reach 120 words per paragraph for these 23 paragraphs, we are 7 words short per paragraph.
We are 7 words short per paragraph.
And there are 23 of them.
23 times 7. 3 sevens are 21, 1, carry 2, 14 plus 2 is 16.
Plus, we need 120 words per paragraph in the preface of the two paragraphs of the preface. 120 words per paragraph, we have two paragraphs in the preface, that's 240.
try to understand, try to stay with me in the story. This is the preface, which is 120 words per paragraph times 2. And it adds up to about 400 words.
About 400 words. What this tells us is that as long as we have 400 words or more in the preface, then the average is going to be, the average for the entire report of 25 paragraphs is going to be 120 words or more than that. In which case, the answer to this question would be no. Is the average number of words per paragraph less than 120? The answer would be no. The average per paragraph is not, the answer would be no. The average number of words per paragraph is not less than 120. If we can establish that the preface has at least 400 words. Did you understand it? Another way to look at it, this is more of an intuitive way. This was more of an intuitive way. Another way to look at the whole thing is to look at it a little bit more mechanically, algebraically. Would you like me to show that? Would you like me to show it to you? How to analyze this thing algebraically? Let's do it then. Let's show it algebraically. We need the room. We're going to do it on the top. Because I don't want to erase all of this thing because we want to be able to compare the two. Let's do it on the top. Let's use W.
Let's use W to represent the number of words, rather the average number of words in the two paragraphs of the preface.
Average number of words in two paragraphs. So what we're looking at is this. What the question is asking is that we have 2,600 words. We have 2,600 words in the 23 paragraphs. If the average number of words per paragraph in the preface is W, then we're going to have 2 times W in the two paragraphs of the preface. That amount has to be divided by 25 because there are altogether 25 paragraphs. And the question is this less than 120? That's what we're looking for. That's what the question is asking. Let's multiply both sides by 25. I said 25 and I write down 12. Let's multiply both sides by 25. And this 25 goes away. And I'm going to write this 120 as 30 times 4. We're going to write this 120 as 30 times 4. Why? Because it's easier. 4 times 25 is 100. 100 times 30 is 3000. So the question now is, is 2600 plus 2W less than, is this less than 3000? Is this less than 3000? Subtract 2600 from both sides, and there you go, voila. The question is, that's what the question is. You see how it's the same exact question, it's the exact same question. The question is, do the two paragraphs in the preface have at least 400 words? That's what we have to establish. And if we can establish that, we are home free. If the two paragraphs in the preface have at least 400 words, then the answer is no. No, the average number of words per paragraph over the entire report of 25 paragraphs is not less than 120. If the two paragraphs in the preface have less than 400 words, then yes, the average, overall average, is less than 120. Do you understand? Let's look at, now we are ready to look at the two statements. You must analyze what is being told. As I always tell you, you must understand what is being asked before you dive into the two statements. Most people have this nasty habit, they read this thing cursorily and they immediately jump in the answer choice in the two statements. And of course, then struggle afterwards because they don't know what is being told, they still don't understand what is being asked. I use a nice vocabulary word just now, even though I say so myself. The word that we just used was cursorily. Let's learn that word, cursory. I know we keep digressing. Cursory is the word. And I know we learned this word because I use the word a lot. And if I use the word in my lectures, then I cover it in the vocabulary lesson. That's the rule. I only cover the words that crop up in the lectures. I make sure that I cover them in the vocabulary lesson in the event that you have some trouble with the vocabulary. You understand? And there are quite a few words beginning with C, so it's going to take a while. C apparently is a very common letter, very popular letter in the alphabet. Cursory, just give me 1 second and be patient, okay? I'm looking at it. I'm looking at my list of the words with C. cursory. It's easy, sometimes it is quicker to do things slowly. It takes longer to do things fast. Oh, there you go, day number 22.
Day 22.
Now I'm going to use the word in the context so you can hear it one more time how it is being used. Now that we understand what is being told and what is being asked, now we are ready to dive into the two statements. The problem that most people have is that they read the problem cursorily. How do they read it? They read the problem cursorily. That's the adverb. You mustn't read it cursorily. You mustn't read the problem in a cursory manner, in a hasty manner. You mustn't read it in haste. You must digest it. You must absorb it. Enough of the said. I'm getting too silly now. I need the break very quickly before I erase it so we can compare the two words. Let's look at the first statement. Now that we understand what we're looking for, it's going to go very fast. We just have to establish whether or not the two paragraphs in the preface have at least 400 words.
The first statement tells us that each paragraph in the preface has more than 100 words.
Well, simply knowing that each of the paragraph has more than 100 words, that does not necessarily mean that they have at least 400 words. They each have more than 100 words, maybe they each have 101 words. 101 words times 2 is not going to be at least 400. Each of them have at least 100 words, maybe they each have 1,000 words. In which case it is more than 400. The first statement, of course, is not enough. Simply knowing that each of the paragraph has more than 100 words does not necessarily mean, that does not enable us to tell whether or not the preface has at least 400 words. The first statement does not do the job.
A, D, B, C, E.
The first statement by itself is not enough. Now that we established the first statement by itself is not enough, we know now answer cannot be A or D. It would have to be either B, C, or E. Let's look at second statement. Second statement tells us that each of the paragraph in the preface
has fewer than 150 words. Aha! If each of them have fewer than 150 words, then the question was, do the two paragraphs in the preface have at least 400 words? The answer is, no, they do not have at least 400 words,
and therefore the answer to their question is the overall average less than 120 words. I believe that was the figure, 120 words. Is the overall average per paragraph less than 120 words? Answer to that question is yes. The overall average is less than 120 words per paragraph because the preface does not contain sufficient number of words that we need. We needed at least 400 words. If each of the paragraph has fewer than 150 words, then of course together they have fewer than 300. We needed them to have 400. Second statement does the job quite beautifully. Is the overall average less than 120 words? The answer is yes. We are able to give a definitive answer. Second statement does the job quite beautifully. Answer to this question is B. That was the end of it. That's all she wrote. I will see you tomorrow. We'll begin the new page. Do you understand? Bye now.